You're listening to the Future Tech Health Podcast with Richard Jacobs. Until I reached age 40, I never realized the obvious, that we all have medical issues, or we at least have a family member or close relation that had, has, or will have them in the future. Medicine and biological systems are the final frontier. Until we've conquered death, figured out how life began, cured cancer, and understood our purpose in the universe, there's a heck of a lot to talk about when it comes to our health. Future Tech Health means I'll be covering futuristic topics that are actually already in clinical trials, or even starting to appear on shelves or by prescription, or available for your own use. We dive deep into stem cells, CRISPR-Cas9, the science of sleep, epigenetics, medical testing, cancer, ketogenic diets, stem cells, aging, regenerative medicine, and more. My goal for you, the listener, is to learn from these podcasts. You may very well learn something that may change the course of your life for the better, steer you towards a new career, or give you insight into addressing a serious medical problem. Remember, however, this podcast and its content is informational in nature only. No medical, tax, legal, financial, or psychological advice is being given. If you enjoy the podcast, please listen, subscribe, like, and share it with friends. Thank you. Hello, this is Richard Jacobs with the Future Tech and Future Tech Health podcast. I have Jessica Pierce. She's a professor and an author. We're going to be talking about inside the very big, very controversial business of dog cloning. She's a author of the book, Unleashing Your Dog, a Field Guide to Giving Your Canine Companion the Best Life Possible. So I love dogs. It sounds like she does too. So Jessica, thanks for coming.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
Yeah, well, it's probably obvious, but why would people want to clone their dog?
I think the easiest answer to that question is because they love their dogs. And, you know, that's the good answer. People are motivated by a really strong bond that they have with a particular animal. And I've had that. I understand that feeling.
Well, what's wrong with cloning your dog? Is it that you can't clone the dog because the dog has lived with you and adapted to you and its environment and become its own unique self, and that can't be cloned? Or are there other biological reasons not to do this?
So I think for me as an ethicist, there are a couple of things that concern me about the cloning of companion animals in particular, you know, focusing on that. And you know, there are broader questions about cloning other kinds of animals, for example, livestock. But talking just about pets, you know, one of the things that concerns me about it is what we were just talking about. I mean, the fact that people have such a strong bond with their animal, but the idea that cloning in a way is a kind of band-aid for grief and for the fact that your animal is going to die. And, you know, to me, it's not a very healthy way to approach the death of a pet, to this idea that you don't ever really have to get to let go, because the animal that if you were to buy a clone, the animal that you will be getting is not the same as the animal that you've lost. It's going to look similar. He or she is going to look similar, but the temperament, behavior is not going to be, you know, you can't just predict what that's going to be like. And it's going to probably be a completely different individual in his or her own right. The more important concern that I have with cloning is the impact that it has on this sort of unseen class of dogs who serve as the tools to create the clone. So, and it's kind of a weird situation. We have, I mean, this one companion animal pet who is so beloved that somebody would spend $50,000 to get an exact copy. And at the same time, the dogs who are used to create that clone are valued only as objects or as tools and really are exploited. And I mean, they're basically dogs who they're lab animals. And their only function really is to create your clone.
I don't understand. Like, what is the cloning process itself? How does it work?
Okay, so So basically, and this is grossly oversimplified, but if you wanted to clone your dog, you would have a couple of cells from, for example, typically a swab of the cheek. So you'd have some DNA. The next step is that a donor dog, and this is where the dogs in the lab come in, a donor dog would be used to harvest eggs. So a dog who's been purchased by the company making your clone, and it probably would be more than one dog, because in the cloning process, you know, it's an imperfect process, and there are a lot of failed attempts and, you know, things that don't work out. So you'd have probably a couple of donor dogs whose eggs would be harvested through a surgical procedure. The eggs from these donor dogs would then be enucleated. In other words, the DNA would be scraped out. And the good DNA, the DNA from the dog that you want to clone, is inserted into the egg. Then, you know, there's this process in the laboratory where, you know, there's a kind of a surge of electricity, and hopefully this encourages the cells to fuse and begin cell division. And then you have an embryo, which is embedded into the womb of a surrogate dog. So this is the second group of laboratory dogs who then would be put into service. The embryo would be implanted into this dog and, you know, the carried to term. And then, you know, I because the process is fairly, it is not transparent, you know, I'm not sure whether the process would involve a natural birth or a cesarean section. It might very well be a cesarean section. And then you would have the puppy, and the surrogate dog would then be, you know, either put into service as a surrogate again, or, you know, be repurposed, as it were, for some other experimental process.
I see what you mean. Yeah. So in the creation of one clone, 2, 3, 4, 5, 10, who knows how many dogs could be used and maybe not used in a good way.
Yeah. And, you know, it's a funny thing to say that you love dogs, yet be willing to put dogs through this process. So, and maybe you love your dog, but don't love dogs, or it's a funny kind of love. I mean, people say that they love pigs and cows and then are perfectly happy to eat them. So, I mean, I know our feelings of love are very complicated when it comes to animals, but that is probably my primary ethical concern with it. And the reason I say, you know, it's typically within my field of bioethics, you know, the interesting issues are ones that are really complex and where there are really compelling arguments on both sides of an issue. And with cloning of pets, to me, it's very simple. It's just wrong. And I don't see any compelling argument in favor of it.
Well, do you think the people that have their pets cloned know of the process? And like, what, you know, how transparent is it to them?
You know, I suspect not very. If you go onto the website of one of the companies that sell cloned pets or that market cloned pets, it all looks very, very happy and simple. And you really don't hear about that backstory. It's, you know, if they were interested in finding out, there's certainly information available. But it's not available on the websites of people who are trying to sell this product. And it's not what you're going to hear. If you ask, oh, how does this work? It's going to sound very kind of neutral and sterile, and not like real dogs with real lives are involved in creating the clone for you.
Well, have you tried to mystery shop the process and go through it yourself and maybe even then disclose who you are and try to visit one of these companies and see what they do?
You know, I haven't tried to visit, and I can almost guarantee that you would not be allowed in the doors. I have not personally tried to present myself as a potential client. I've talked to people who've been through the process themselves, and, you know, it's a really mixed bag. There are people who, you know, because I've written about cloning and have written quite clearly that I'm opposed to it, I get emails from people who say, you know, it's the greatest thing I've ever done. I love my cloned dog more than anything in the world. And, you know, it's brought me tremendous happiness. And then there are people who have described to me processes that seem quite almost cloak and dagger. Like, you never actually go to the facility to get your dog. You know, they meet you in a hotel lobby and hand out. It's almost like a drug deal, you know. It is not a transparent business transaction from what I can tell.
Have you interviewed people who have gotten cloned dogs? Like, have they been willing to show you, you know, pictures of Fluffy,
yeah,
the senior, now Fluffy, the new one, and have you compared them?
Yeah, and, you know, often they look very similar. I've had a couple of people tell me that the cloned dog, and now it's becoming more common, I think, to clone cats, but I've never actually talked to somebody who had their cat cloned, but people who've had their dogs cloned will, you know, I've had some say, oh, he's very much like he or she, very much like the original dog. And then others who say, there's nothing like the original. And even people who have expressed considerable disappointment because they were expecting, you know, A, and they got B. And, you know, when you get a mismatch in expectations like that, it's often not good for the person or the dog. And then people who have talked to me who've had really negative experiences, you know, there's not a lot of research on whether cloned dogs have more health problems than, you know, normal, not cloned dogs. And most cloned dogs are too young yet to really know what the long-term effects are going to be. But I talked to one woman who had just one medical problem after another with this dog who she had gotten, this clone, and was running their bank account dry and tremendously stressful. And so I think it's all over the board. But, you know, it's not the sort of thing where if you're disappointed with it, you could return a dog, I suppose. That sounds like such a horrible thing, because dogs are not objects. But, you know, you outlay all this cash and, you know, what do you do if it's not what you expect? None of those scenarios look very good for the dog.
No, that's true. The dog doesn't know any better. And it's growing up expecting it to behave a certain way. And maybe even, surely the owner probably, I don't know, in their mind, they're thinking the dog must know me, you know, somehow cosmically, it must still know me. Maybe they're looking for that.
Yeah.
But they certainly have that expectation that it's just like old Fluffy. And so, like, who knows if that turns into an abusive relationship, if the dog's not like old Fluffy, and, you know, the poor thing has no clue, like, what it's supposed to be living up to. And yeah, it just seems like a sad thing that really, you know, the genie's out of the bottle, the old dog passed, you really can't get it back. It's better to just honor its memory and to try to do this thing.
Yeah, and I, you know, one of the things that has been distressing to me is to see cloning companies trying to market specifically to people who have elderly or ill animals. So targeting you know, an audience and trying to sort of get in the door with veterinary hospice practices. And to me, that's really a problem, because people who are facing the loss of an animal who is dearly beloved to them are not, I hate to say it as bluntly as this, but they're not thinking clearly. And I've been through the process myself, so I can say that about myself. You're vulnerable. And, you know, the the anticipation of loss can really make you do things or make decisions that aren't necessarily in your own best interests or in the best interests of animals, maybe not your particular animal who's passing away, but and I think preying on people who are in that vulnerable state, either having just lost an animal or anticipating a loss, is wrong. And what they need is a social worker who's trained in bereavement counseling to help them through the passing of their animal, and not, you know, with this idea that you can somehow make it better, because nothing can make it better. Yeah. You know, and
well, there's even advice out there that, you know, if you have a dog that dies, you should wait. Don't just adopt one right away, even a different one.
Yeah.
You know, wait a few months. So like, you're not just trying to replace, and you know, you don't shortcut the grief process.
Exactly. And I think that you've hit the nail on the head there with that, is to have a normal, I mean, that normal in scare quotes there, because everybody's grieving process is unique to them, but to be able to really grieve properly. And to me, to honor your animal is to, you know, my dog Maya, who passed away last summer, and the last thing that I would do would be clone her, because she is so special to me, as she is, and she's unique, and I don't want to replace her, you know?
I understand.
So, yeah.
What do you want your role to be in this, you know, niche of the world?
Well, I think my role is as naysayer, which isn't always a good role to be in, but I guess what I really would like to say to people is to put the brakes on and really think through whether this is a good idea. You know, I know the technology is speeding forward. The market is growing. So I have no great ideas that I'm going to actually stop this from happening. But I would like people to understand the backstory and recognize that it's not a good thing for animals in general. And it's not necessarily a good thing even for dog owners or cat owners who are facing loss.
Well, maybe the best thing to do is to assemble as many stories as you can of what happened with the people that wanted the cloning. You know, like stories of what was the process like? Did they meet you in an underground parking garage and hand them a bag of cash and a paper bag? You know, was it more formalized? And then when you got the pet home, was it just like the old Fluffy, or was it now totally different? And maybe if you assemble enough of these stories, and, you know, many of them are bad, which they probably are, maybe that's the best way, is to show other people it's not a good idea. It's not what you think. And you have a big compendium of these things, you know, maybe a book.
Yeah. Yeah. I think it would make a fascinating book. And I bet you $100 there are already 5 or 10 books in the works on pet cloning, because, yeah, it's amazing to me. I think I get asked for more interviews on dog and cat cloning than on pretty much anything else. And people are really interested in it, and also, I would say, concerned about it, not thinking uncritically about the problems that this technology is forcing upon us. And I think, you know, you can't talk about the cloning of dogs and cats without also kind of slipping into a conversation about the cloning of people. And, you know, the loss of someone, facing a loss of a pet who is so important to you, you know, can imagine, and people go to great lengths to find a way to deal with that, sometimes through cloning. And you can imagine parents who have a lot of financial resources and who have lost a child, in the same way, kind of grasping for any kind of way to deal with that loss. And, you know, it may be illegal, but it's coming down the pike. I can guarantee it.
I guess on a slightly different subject, what is your professorship about and your book about? You know, are they same issue or ancillary issues around this?
So really, it's not about the same thing at all. The book Unleashing Your Dog is for, it certainly would be as of interest to people with cloned dogs and non-cloned dogs. It's about using the science of what we know about dog cognition and emotion to give our canine companions the best possible life we can. To give a really simple example, you know, humans are very, we're visual mammals and, you know, really kind of think through our eyes and experience the world largely through our visual sense. And dogs are olfactory animals. They experience the world largely and initially through their noses. And so, you know, recognizing how important the sense of smell is to our dogs can help us give them a better life in that, you know, for example, taking a dog for a walk, giving them ample time to explore the world through their nose and not just say, oh, you know, there's nothing there when they're sniffing a plant or the sidewalk and we don't see anything. But to them, there is a lot of interesting information to be had, and, you know, letting them really have as many rich sensory experiences as possible. And I mean, the connection between the ideas in Unleashing Your Dog and dog cloning are just that dogs are not objects. They shouldn't be used as objects in commercial businesses or in research laboratories, because they have incredibly rich inner lives and emotional lives. And so it's really about, you know, recognizing the unique value of each individual dog's life.
Have you seen any experiments where they've had dogs like smell every day hundreds of different things and see if it changes their behavior, their brain, or, you know, like really like given dogs so many tons of things to smell, much more than they normally would smell, and what it did to them?
No, that's a good question. What pops to mind is a study that was where dogs were basically given, you know, free access to as much smelling as they wanted. And they spent about a third of their time. So a third of their time budget was dedicated to just smelling things. So, you know, if you think about taking an hour long walk, 20 minutes of that, you might spend just standing there while your dog sniffs. So I have wondered whether, you know, if dogs were given complete free rein, would they get some olfactory overload? And I don't think they would. I do think they might get olfactory overload from some of the smells that we kind of force upon them in our homes. For example, you know, if you're burning incense or spraying on way too much perfume or cologne or using really strong shampoos, especially on your dog, you know, the idea that dogs would like to smell like lavender or tea tree, you know, I don't think so. I think they'd rather probably smell like the dead animal that they rolled in, or, you know, dry grass, or just themselves. You know, they have a kind of olfactory sense of self. But yeah, I think there's a lot we still don't understand.
Yeah, I was imagining, like, what if I owned a dog daycare place and, you know, like I brought in, like, I don't know, soil samples from different places and different smells. And that was part of, like, the care I gave to the dogs. Like, every day, you know, like you board your dog here, we're going to, you know, show them like 30 new smells or something as part of their care package that they get when they come.
Yeah.
I just wonder if that would make happier dogs. I don't know.
Yeah, I think it's a great idea. I like it.
Yeah, I don't know. You know, dogs are interesting. I have three, you know, myself. And I just wonder about
it. Yeah, I know. They are a source of continual wonderment if you stop and really watch them and pay attention. And I imagine with having three, they're completely different individuals and personalities.
Yeah, they're funny. Like, they get jealous, you know, like, you know, they have toys and they may not want a toy, but as soon as another one has it, they get jealous and then they want the toy. And, you know, if my wife gives them bones, like, they'll all start out with their own bone you know, jealously eating it. And then they'll see the other one's bone and they'll want that one instead of theirs. And then they'll steal that one. The other one goes back and steals theirs. You know, it's just funny the things they do.
Yeah, they are fun to watch, aren't they? And a good mirrors for our own behaviors, like thinking the grass is always greener on the other side. Or, you know, when I go out to eat with my husband, you know, his meal always looks more appealing than mine.
Yeah,
so I think we're not so different from our canine friends.
Well, I don't know if you've observed dogs very closely for a long time. It sounds like you have, but like, any interesting things that you feel like you've discovered about them that's not commonly talked about?
Oh, that's a good question. It seems like, I would say no. I mean, there are a lot of things that I have observed about dogs that I think are really interesting, but they've all been talked about because dogs really are so popular right now as a subject of study, which I think is wonderful. And it's so different from even a decade ago, but especially, you know, 2 decades ago or 3 decades ago, where people, as serious scientists, didn't study dogs because they're domesticated animals, they're not real animals. That's really changed. And I'd say a day doesn't go by where I see some new study in a journal about some aspect of dog behavior, dog cognition, dog emotions. So it's really exploding, and it's really fun to watch because they're such interesting animals, and it's surprising how little we know about them. And so there's just this whole world that is opening up to us and those of us who love dogs and kind of pay attention to this literature. So constantly amazed at what we're learning.
Yeah, for people that are interested, what kind of publications or literature, like what are the names of some of the places where you get your info from?
Well, I get a lot of alerts just from journals in ethology, and those are not always easy to read if you don't have a background in animal behavior. But there are, like, Science Daily is a news feed that they do all kinds of different scientific subjects, but they always pick up on the stories that are related to dogs and dog behavior. And you can sign up for a daily feed. And so I kind of watch the Science Direct, and they always do a really nice job of translating the scientific information into, you know, something that is digestible for non-experts. So, and, you know, even magazines like The Bark will often feature this new research that's coming out, or the Whole Dog Journal. A lot of different places. So those are a couple that people might watch.
Well, what are some of, like, the hot areas in dog research right now?
Some of the things that I think are really interesting are trying to suss out what behavioral changes occurred during domestication that differentiate dog behavior from wolf behavior. And it's very controversial. To give an example, it's been suggested that dogs have uniquely evolved to communicate with humans through facial expressions and are much more adept at understanding human faces and paying attention to them. For example, you know, following human gaze, following human pointing gestures. So Brian Hare, who has a dog cognition lab, that's another good place for a lot of interesting information if people want to look up Brian Hare. He's done a lot of work on, you know, seeing whether dogs and to what extent dogs follow pointing gestures and human gaze compared to wolves. And I think that's pretty interesting. And I was just reading a study that came out within the last couple of weeks about the facial anatomy of dogs compared to wolves, and that very distinctive expression that dogs make that we call puppy dog eyes, use facial muscles that wolves don't have. And I think that's pretty interesting stuff. So yeah, I could probably talk for at least 5 or 6 hours about
this research. I mean, it's rare to find someone that's interested. So yeah. Like I noticed, it's funny, you know, they'll be hungry and they'll look at you and you'll give them food. And then a second later, they look the exact same as if they've never eaten the food.
I know. They have perfected the gaze.
Yeah, my wife will say they haven't had anything all day. Those poor things. Look at them. You know, I'm like, all right, stop. And they always say to her, have you fed them? She goes, would you please? Yes, I fed them, because they look like that all the time. You know?
I know. And it's, you know, sometimes I feel sort of judgmental about, you know, how many fat dogs there are, but I totally get it. They have learned how to milk us for every little morsel. And my dog, Bella, could probably use a couple pounds off too. So that, oh my God, I'm starving to death look is really effective.
Yeah, I used to go to this chiropractor, and he had a dog named Radar, and I would come in and Radar would come up and whimper, and I would give him a bone, you know, little bones there, you know? And then one time I asked the secretary, I said, how many times does the dog get fed a day? She's like, probably 40. I said, really? And she goes, watch. So another person came in and Radar ignored me after I gave him the bone and went up to the new person and whimpered. And they go, oh, Radar. And they gave him a bone. Then he left that person. The next person came in. He did the exact same thing. So all day long, the dog was doing this to everybody, and it got everyone to give him something.
That's great. That's a good story.
Really funny. Yeah.
And was Radar a little chunky?
Actually, no.
No, good.
He was okay, yeah. He just was really good at acting, you know, and he was just like you said, as soon as you fed him, he was like, all right, bye. That's it. And he went on to the next person. So he knew what he needed to do.
Yeah. So, dogs have definitely, I mean, if you know, people, not very many these days, but there are still people who don't think dogs are very smart. I think they're crazy, because dogs have definitely learned how to interact effectively with their human counterparts.
Yeah, definitely. Do you think they actually care about people? Like, do you think they feel emotional and they love them, or are they just using them for food? What do you think?
You know, that's a good question. I think dogs do love us, but I also think we can project a lot of feelings onto them that we want them to have or hope that they have, that they may not have. And, you know, there's this idea that dogs are totally dependent on us and we're their best friends and they're our best friends. And like, to me, that's a little bit overblown. And, you know, one thing that I've been thinking about recently in relation to a book that I'm working on now is the fact that around 80% of the dogs on the planet don't actually live as pets in human homes. And they live instead as street dogs or feral dogs or free roaming dogs or some combination of those. And they do quite well on their own. I mean, they're dependent on humans to a certain extent in that they, for the most part, scavenge for, you know, on human food sources of one sort or another. But they don't need us unconditionally. Yeah, I think we can be sometimes a bit patronizing toward our dogs and need to remember that they're perfectly capable animals in their own right and not just pets.
Yeah, that's true. Well, very good. So you've given some ways for people to find out more about dogs, which is good. And then where can they, can you restate your book's title and where can they get it?
Sure. So the most recent book is called Unleashing Your Dog, and I wrote it with my colleague, Mark Beckhoff, who is an ethologist. So he studies animal behavior, and you can get it from New World Library, which is the publisher, or on Amazon and Barnes & Noble and probably any other, you know, these online booksellers. But those are a couple of places where it's available.
All right, excellent. And any last things that you want to mention that maybe I haven't asked you, you want to cover?
No, I think we've covered a lot of ground.
Okay, well, very good. Well, I appreciate you coming on the podcast. It's been a good call.
Yeah, thanks for having me on, and enjoy the rest of your day.
You're listening to the Future Tech Health Podcast with Richard Jacobs. Until I reached age 40, I never realized the obvious, that we all have medical issues, or we at least have a family member or close relation that had, has, or will have them in the future. Medicine and biological systems are the final frontier. Until we've conquered death, figured out how life began, cured cancer, and understood our purpose in the universe, there's a heck of a lot to talk about when it comes to our health. Future Tech Health means I'll be covering futuristic topics that are actually already in clinical trials, or even starting to appear on shelves, or by prescription, or available for your own use. We dive deep into stem cells, CRISPR-Cas9, the science of sleep, epigenetics, medical testing, cancer, ketogenic diets, stem cells, aging, regenerative medicine, and more. My goal for you, the listener, is to learn from these podcasts. You may very well learn something that may change the course of your life for the better, steer you towards a new career, or give you insight into addressing a serious medical problem. Remember, however, this podcast and its content is informational in nature only. No medical, tax, legal, financial, or psychological advice is being given. If you enjoy the podcast, please listen, subscribe, like, and share it with friends. Thank you.